I found that many people are only vaguely aware of 40B, or all they know is that it has something to do with affordable housing, but that people who know a little more about it, especially if they've had 40Bs proposed in their neighborhood, have concerns and anxiety. Why is that?
I think 40B comes as a surprise to many folks when they find out that the house that they bought in a neighborhood that's zoned for, say, single-family use is allowed to be developed in something other than a single-family use. And if they put up a fence or they were expecting to have a, say, 25-foot setback, that setback doesn't necessarily apply to a project that might be proposed under 40B. So part of the shock that may come when a 40B is proposed in your neighborhood is that they don't have to comply with the rules that, say, your house does.
And I'd add, Julia, good afternoon. Zoning in this country was adopted in many cities, including Cambridge and Boston, in the early 1900s. Around the 1950s, most municipalities in Massachusetts adopted zoning. And zoning is what your city council or in other communities, town meeting has adopted to establish the ground rules for land use development: residential, commercial, industrial, height of buildings, bulk of buildings, and other aspects of development that we see on a daily basis. If you walk down the street, the reason a house is set back a certain distance from the front yard is because of zoning. The reason a structure is 30 feet instead of 80 feet is because of zoning. What Chapter 40B does, and we're the only state in the nation that does it, is it takes all of those local zoning characteristics, all of them, no exceptions, and it casts them aside. So why would a neighborhood be concerned about those rules being cast aside? Because it seems arbitrary, because it seems offensive, because it violates due process, and because it's totally and completely irrational. 49 other states construct affordable housing in a different way, successfully in a different way. We're the only state in the nation that allows a developer to cast locally adopted rules and regulations that all of us are party to out the window for a particular project.
As I think a lot of people here know, Newton has some very large 40B developments already built: Arbor Point at Woodlands, Avalon Chestnut Hill, Avalon Newton Highlands. And in the past 3 years or so, there's been a lot of activity. We've had 40Bs approved at Court Street, where two houses were just demolished a couple of weeks ago to clear the site. Myrtle Village and Taft Avenue, smaller projects, and a 40B is approved at Goddard Street with conditions that are being appealed by the developer. We've also got a Zoning Board of Appeals hearing underway for the 48-unit proposal at St. Philip Neri. There's another 24-unit apartment building proposed right next door at the Staples Craft farmhouse site. And there's another proposal, 9 units, at another National Register historic site on Cherry Street that's in the early stages. And in my neighborhood of West Newton-Auburndale, the Rowe Street proposal was just withdrawn. And at Wells Ave, it looks like the developer is going to litigate the city's refusal to approve lifting a deed restriction that would allow a huge 40B there. So why is Newton such a target for 40B developers?
Well, as an outsider, I don't live in Newton, although my family in part is from Newton. It's an attractive municipality. It has all the attributes of attractiveness to a land developer. It's close to the city of Boston, some obvious things. And then maybe some less obvious things, which is it has a large land base. And a large land base is attractive to the development community because there are parcels of land that, in a developer's mind, are undervalued, and with a greater density made allowable by 40B, it's attractive. So every time there's a pre-existing non-conforming structure, every time there's a house on a lot and the lot doesn't conform to zoning, every time there's a house that might be more beneficially developed in greater density, it's a target for 40B. Another way of saying it is, no matter where you live in Massachusetts, with the specter of 40B hanging over your head, no parcel is safe. It's the communities that thought they were safe because they've achieved a standard, only to be told that they didn't achieve it. Those communities have seen underdeveloped parcels and parcels of land that they thought were preserved for open space, thought they were preserved for one use or another. Or in the communities that I represent, cities and towns like Middleborough, like Wareham, very blue collar, very affordable homes are being removed to build pursuant to 40B. So the irony of ironies under 40B is those homes sometimes that are the most affordable, including mobile home parks, which don't count on the town's subsidized housing inventory, are targets for 40B developments. Why? Because 40B allows a developer to have 75% of the units at market and only 25% below market.
I'll add to that. Julia, Newton's a target, I think, not only because it's a strong residential housing market, good schools, but it also has infrastructure. A sewer system is a huge bonus for a Chapter 40B development because you don't have to comply with the state Title V wastewater requirements.
I think a lot of us forget that not everybody has sewers even, and we kind of take that for granted. For a long time, people in Newton were under the impression that we had to have 10% of our housing units be officially affordable to be exempt from Chapter 40B's requirements. In fact, that was all anyone ever talked about, how hard it was going to be to get to the 10%. But that's not really true, is it? The 1.5% land area minimum is an equally valid way to satisfy 40B, and you only have to do one, not both.
Yeah. So maybe a couple things, if I could, Julia. First, getting to one of these standards, 10%, 1.5%, or the standards found in the regulations, and then there's one additional standard in the statute. Getting to that status does not mean that the community cannot approve comprehensive permits. It only means that a developer who's unsatisfied with the Board of Appeals decision can't appeal it to the Housing Appeals Committee. So there are countless communities in the Commonwealth that have achieved the 10% status, the 1.5% status, or any of the other statuses that have approved comprehensive permits. But they've done it in accordance with a plan. They've done it in accordance with common sense, rational basis thinking. So the first comment is, getting to a standard doesn't mean it's the end of affordable housing. Just the contrary. Look at Cambridge. Look at Amherst. They've been over the 10% standard for decades, and yet they're producing affordable housing in a very consistent manner in accordance with their plan. So this concept that being at a milestone means you'll never construct comprehensive permits again is false. In the communities we represent, we've developed affordable housing through town-sponsored projects, even though the town doesn't have to accomplish that. So 40B is a vehicle that can be used in concert with a plan, not as a bludgeon used by the private sector.
And just to add to that, the basic ways to satisfy the mandate of the statute, 10% of your year-round housing stock is affordable and deed-restricted for at least 30 years. That's one way. The other way is that 1.5% of your land area is similarly deed-restricted for affordable housing. And the others have to do with progress toward those ends under an approved housing production plan. And there are different percentages based on the plan.
Thank you. I've done some research, and I discovered that Newton actually has far more subsidized affordable units in absolute terms and more subsidized units per square mile than a number of municipalities that have already met the 10% threshold. And it seems like for built-out communities like Newton, reaching that 10% is really very difficult, if not impossible. Is that why the 1.5% standard was included in the first place?
Well, I think it's difficult for a community that's mostly built out, it's difficult because every time you're building more housing and only a quarter of it is affordable, you're changing the denominator as well as the numerator, and you're making it very difficult mathematically. Your density has to go exponentially higher. The other thing about the 10% subsidized housing, that is a snapshot in time, and the denominator is reset every census, every 10 years, based on the number of units, total year-round housing units, as counted in the U.S. Census. So communities that, at one point, maybe over 10% find themselves after the next census, that may no longer be the case. For the 1.5% threshold, that is thought to be, it's, you know, a relatively new phenomenon. There's only a few communities that have achieved it, and only a few others that have tried. That is thought to be based on land area, something that, unless there's expiring units that come off the SHI, that is thought to be something that once you achieve it, it's likely to stay the case.
Because with units, I know, well, we see in Newton the phenomenon where we have single and two-family houses getting torn down, and a developer will put in five units, so that's, they keep finding ways to squeeze in more and more units, so our denominator in the unit calculation keeps growing for that reason.
Julie, if I could also add, just the definition of subsidized housing is of great interest and I think commonly misunderstood. In order to count the units towards the 10% or the 1.5%, the unit has to be placed on a list maintained by the Commonwealth, the Department of Housing and Community Development. That's called the Subsidized Housing Inventory. It's online. You can check it. They update it periodically, although not all that often. That definition of subsidized does not mean affordable. In fact, there are thousands and thousands and thousands of dwelling units in the Commonwealth that are very affordable, but they're not on the list. They're only on the list if DHCD determines that they go on the list. And that formula for being placed on the list is not rational, it's arbitrary. So a mobile home selling for $100,000, Wareham, Carver, Middleborough, not on the list. A unit that is otherwise affordable because it's small, it's not competitive, not on the list. So in order to get placed on the list, the municipality like Newton has to jump through the hoops established by DHCD, and in order to be stay on the list, the unit has to remain affordable. So a developer that builds a 40B project in Newton or anywhere else, if those units expire, and historically they expired in 15 years, more recently they expire in 30 years, and until very recently a developer would put up a fight saying it would never go longer than 30 years, those units come off the list. So here today, gone tomorrow, you could be at the 1.5% calculation or be at the 10% calculation and lose those units. It's happening every day in Newton. It's happening every day elsewhere in the Commonwealth. And those moments of being there and then losing it can only be preserved. The municipality can only preserve it if they go back and make sure that those units never come off the list. It requires the municipality affirmatively to make sure these units don't get taken off the list. Because you may feel you're at a threshold today, 1.5%, but that could be lost, not on the land area, as Dennis was saying, but could be lost because the land, the units themselves fall off this 30-year or 15-year restriction.
Does the city or town have any leverage at the outset to ensure that a project will be affordable in perpetuity? Can they insist on that at the stage it's going to the Zoning Board of Appeals?
Yes. The answer is yes.
Even if the developer claims uneconomic or something like that?
The developer would have no dog in that fight. The developer's economics are measured at the time of the application, not at the time 30 years or 50 years down the road. So categorically, the answer is yes. And most recently, most developers have kind of conceded that point. Mm-hmm. Many have, or many perhaps have not, but the majority certainly have.
And with regard to, projects approved long ago that have expiring units, what's the city or town's leverage to make sure that they don't expire when that date rolls around?
Well, as Professor Witten said, the reason that units must remain affordable in perpetuity is because of a case that was decided about 10 years ago by the state's highest court, the SJC, the Ardmore case, where they said that they have to apply for the longest period allowed by law, which is usually required under the subsidy, or so long as they don't comply with zoning. So in a typical 40B, there's more than one, and sometimes many, waivers of zoning bylaws, and as long as the project that has been built doesn't comply totally with the bylaw, then it must remain affordable in perpetuity. So that's really the rationale for, you know, keeping them affordable forever.
Okay. So in practical terms, even if something has an expiration date, it's likely going to stay affordable in perpetuity. Although if, suppose, you know, suppose our city council decided to rezone around something that was, had expiring units and rezoned in a way that made it then conforming, would that cause the units to then automatically go to market?
So if the city council wanted to pull the rug out from under its own municipality by creating or removing from a subsidized housing inventory units that were intentionally built as subsidized housing,
mm-hmm. yeah.
then the city council would have to rezone to make the units conforming in all aspects to zoning, which in and of itself would be very difficult. It probably would constitute spot zoning and therefore be illegal. And it would be undercutting the very purpose of allowing the units to be built in the first place under 40B. The other piece is these units are to remain affordable because of the Ardmore decision, but also the regulatory agreement that the developer has signed with the municipality. And the regulatory agreement should contain language, increasingly so today, that requires the units to remain perpetually affordable. So even if the city council were to try that kind of crazy maneuver, the units would be perpetually restricted by the regulatory agreement. So for a municipality that's struggling with that issue, you should look at the regulatory agreement that was signed historically with these units to see if the language of perpetual restrictions are in there. That's more of a recent phenomenon. I'd say the past 5 to 10 years, cities and towns have now put in the regulatory agreement that the units remain perpetually affordable. I mean, let's look at it this way. You've given up zoning. You've given away everything you've adopted all these years through zoning since the 50s. You've given that up under the guise of an affordable housing development. You want to retain those units. Why would you give up something so important to the land use scheme in the United States as zoning, only to lose the units 30 years later? The joke is on us if we're allowing the development community to do that. Because then you achieve the standard, you create the units, and then you lose the units. And let's think about what happens when you lose the units. I can't tell you how many cases we've litigated where an affordable unit, one that we in good faith approved, gets lost to a market rate conversion. The joke's on us. If a developer is selling us a waiver of zoning to create affordability, then those units should be perpetually affordable because that's why we gave the waiver. But that unit, instead of selling for $185,000, which is what it would sell for in Newton today, or $200,000, then sells for $500,000, how is that equitable? How is that fair? How does that fulfill the purposes of 40B? Of course it doesn't. Yeah. So once the units are created, any rational thought would say you keep them affordable.
And then with the rentals, you'd have massive numbers of people suddenly finding their units unaffordable. In the absence of having met either the 10% standard or the 1.5% standard or making adequate progress on the, I guess it's the housing production plan option, is there any limit a community can place on how big a 40B project can be, how many stories tall, or how high a floor area ratio?
No, there aren't any benchmarks. There is a design handbook. It used to have a 8-to-1 or 8 units per acre that was written out a few years ago. But really, there's just basic design criteria, but there aren't clear benchmarks or guidance on density or floor area ratio or height or anything like that.
And I think that's one of the most remarkable things about the statute for those of you that have dealt with it either personally or kind of from a distance. Think about a statutory scheme that says there are no local rules. I mean, that wouldn't be tolerable any other state in the country. But for some reason, we've tolerated it here because we've wrapped this cloak of affordability around it. It's all about creating affordable housing, which I don't think anybody in this room or any of the communities I represent feel any differently about. Everyone believes affordable housing is a key municipal objective. But there's also 15 other key municipal objectives, including open space and public schools and public transportation and infrastructure. When one goal or issue trumps and obliterates all the others, that's a recipe for disaster. I mean, maybe there's a reason why there's no other state in the nation that does it this way. Maybe there's a reason for it. Because when we take this concept, as Dennis said so well, that says you can take that parcel of land next door, raise whatever's there, and there are no rules that apply, that's going to get people upset. Why? Because we're snobs? No. Because we believe in fairness and due process and rational planning and thinking. When you take those rules away, people get angry. It's insulting. It's wholly insulting to a democratic process. And that's why 40B has been so controversial for 40 plus years.
Yeah. On the subject of size, I read an article recently that I guess a 40B that's proposed in Brookline, they're actually proposing parking stackers for the cars to fit in more units and the cars associated with them. And I know we've seen in Newton on non-40B projects, an increasing number seem to involve underground, sort of commercial style underground parking garages to pack in more units per acre than you'd normally expect. And these are on special permits, so I assume the idea has occurred to 40B developers as well.
Well, in 2008, the regulations changed to say that you can include in a 40B non-residential uses. So we could have a 40B next door that would include a small convenience store, or a small recreational facility for charge, or a small commercial use. The regulations are far more destructive than the statute itself, and it's worth taking a look at how the regulations read. Municipalities can't probe a developer's profit, which of course is the entire cornerstone of the statute, until at the end of the process. Municipalities can't require a whole bunch of information until the end of the process. A municipality has to make a decision on the 1.5% to the 10% calculation within 15 days of opening a public hearing. What municipality is able to do that? Newton, maybe, because it's sophisticated and it has a staff, but think about a rural community that has no staff. The regulations have wholesale changed the statute, totally outside of the purpose of the statute. They're being challenged right now in a case out of Stoneham and a case out of Waltham. But the one sleeper out there that you should be aware of is the non-residential component of a 40B. So I could build my 200 units and I could have a small convenience store downstairs. I could have a small grocery store. I could have a small whatever, used car lot, because the regulations allow for it. And that's made the statutory scheme even more punitive to cities and towns.
Could you explain a little about the difference between the law? I understand the law is very short. I think it's only about 4 pages. I looked at it, and then the regulations are very long, and yet they're still somewhat vague and incomplete when it comes to things like how to calculate the 1.5% land area ratio, numerator and denominator and all that. So what's the story on regulations? How do they get changed? Who has the power to change them?
The state agency that administers the statute and is empowered by the statute to promulgate regulations is the Department of Housing and Community Development. And their avowed purpose is to facilitate the development, economic development, but in particular the development of affordable housing. 40B is a, as you alluded to, a 4-page statute. 40A fills an entire volume in the general laws. 40A is the zoning, positive zoning code that allows municipalities to adopt zoning. And the sad truth is, in 2016, nobody builds under zoning. There aren't any subdivisions, clusters, planned developments, and we practically don't even use 40A because almost everything is done residential development under 40B because, as John alluded to just a moment ago, the rules don't apply. So the regulations have grown up through DHCD largely to effectuate its purpose. And the case law has largely supported that, often described as a remedial purpose. Agencies that are interpreting and promulgating their own regulations are often paid deference by courts. And so you see that the regulations are constantly evolving and being interpreted often in a way to effectuate the purpose of the statute to develop affordable housing.
And does anyone have to approve the DHCD's rewriting of its regulations?
DHCD.
Okay.
Supposedly through a public hearing process, but not always. There have been instances, I think the 2008 regulatory change was done under an emergency order that was initially temporary, and only after folks howled did they go back and have a public hearing process.
Okay. On the flip side of not meeting either one of the standards, what are the advantages to a community if you reach a threshold and stay there?
Well, your plan, Newton has a sophisticated planning department. Newton has a long history of planning. Massachusetts is one of the handful of non-planned states in the nation. So 25 states, and you can't generalize these states. So 25 states including Georgia, Rhode Island, and then the bulk of the western states require a plan to be upon the basis upon which zoning is adopted. So the plan provides the vision, zoning implements the vision. And that's the way it works in the majority of states. It's called plan states. Massachusetts has rejected that principle since Mike Dukakis was governor. It was the last serious attempt in discussing having plan state legislation. So the advantage of achieving one of these milestones, 1.5%, 10% plan production, is that your decisions regarding land use and development can adhere to your plan. That this end run around local zoning, this eradication of all local zoning principles, is actually in effect. So the Board of Appeals now can say to a developer proposing a 40B, does this project conform with the plan? And if it does, then the Board of Appeals can logically approve it and condition it. If it doesn't, then the Board of Appeals can logically deny it. And because you're at this standard, this threshold, this so-called consistent with local needs standard, it would make sense to reject a proposal, a project that doesn't comport with the plan. And that's the way it works in the majority of states. So the real advantage is regaining control over your land use destiny. By being at this standard, you've accomplished what the majority of communities have not accomplished and will never accomplish because it's such an impossible standard to meet in most jurisdictions. But once you're there, it would be ironic indeed to look the other way and approve an application just because it's under 40B. The approval of the application should be, does it comport with the plan? And if it doesn't, then being at the standard allows the board to reject it.
The other thing I'd add is it also returns local control to the municipality to make the judgment of how much do we need affordable housing in our community versus how much should we apply the rules that apply to everyone else in this neighborhood or in this community to this project. And that balancing is, in my view, best done locally and not necessarily at the state, which I think we'll talk about later, is the state agency that often reviews Chapter 40B comprehensive permits that are issued by a zoning board.
And Julia, I'd also add, once a municipality has achieved the standard of consistent with local needs, as Newton has, then a comprehensive permit project is entirely malleable to you. Perhaps you need elderly housing. Perhaps you need more handicap housing. Perhaps you need more rental housing. Perhaps you need more moderate income housing. Perhaps you need a greater local preference with the regulations support and allow. So it's control, as Dennis says. And control in the affordable housing world is important so you can tailor what you need to this particular project. This isn't all about a developer getting 70% market rate and 25% below market. Imagine telling a developer in a community like Newton that's achieved the standard, you know what, we need 80% of these units affordable. We need 80% of these units to be for elderly housing or whatever it is that the municipality needs. So that kind of control changes the game. It's not developer driven, it's municipality driven. And of course, that's the best end result.
Yeah, I think a lot of those factors you mentioned are things that people would actually welcome more of, like the senior housing, and I think a lot of the objection to the larger 40Bs or developments in general that are proposed is that there's not a higher percentage of affordable units. And I know in Newton, particularly, we have a relatively low percent of commercial tax base, and there's a couple of examples recently where the developers are going after commercial properties to do 40Bs, which would take them off the commercial tax rolls, which has been a concern. Another thing that I've noticed with regard to DHCD, and they do seem to make things difficult. I guess the Housing Appeals Committee, by their own admission, they rule for the developer 75% of the time, and I've heard that it's even higher. And they seem to be making it difficult to prove the 1.5%, especially where you need land areas for what are called confidential units. I guess they're protected information. The addresses, because of the people that live in them, need protection. But why can't the associated land areas, even an aggregate number, be provided and kind of vetted by a trustworthy third party? What's being done to address that problem?
I can speak to that, Julia. I'm counsel of record in that Norwood case where a resident of Norwood sought, through a public information request, not to know the location or even necessarily the address of group homes that are on the subsidized housing inventory. These are on the list. They count. The state has decided that they count. But they don't really count for purposes of land area calculation because no one knows how much area is associated. So we tried to compel the state agencies that collectively have this information, the Department of Developmental Services and the DHCD, because that information is reported internally on the number of units by community, but no one reports the acreage associated with those units. And we tried every way imaginable to just get the information. All we need is a number, the amount of acreage associated with a particular unit. And we weren't able to make that happen. There's a active case that we're waiting for a decision, and I remain hopeful but guardedly optimistic.
So this is going through up through the appeals process?
It's in the courts right now.
Land court, and could it go to SJC potentially?
Potentially, and if not this particular case, then I imagine it will at some point. Part of the issue is that the SHI was created a long time ago, and the state, for years and years and years, has counted units, but it has never kept a running tally of land area. The SHI is only as good as the information that is provided to DHCD. There isn't a bureaucrat out there for the state who maintains the SHI. They collect forms and data from municipalities and the DHCD aggregates it on a list. Well, when you fill out the form, you put a number of units and other information, and it's just as easy to put the data about the acreage associated with that parcel. And it really ought to be part of the SHI so that there isn't this, after the fact adversarial proceeding where municipalities are fighting with a state agency about whether they do or don't have enough land area. Just like the number of units is on a list that's updated regularly and deemed by regulation to be the actual number of units on the SHI, they should have acreage that's kept and tallied in the same way.
And just taking that a step further, imagine a statutory scheme that says, if you meet this criteria, you will achieve consistent with local needs status. But one of the elements of the criteria, we're not going to tell you.
Right.
And that's how it works.
Yeah.
So the town of Stoneham, we're litigating this very same matter that Dennis was talking about, which is this a game? Or are we being treated like children? You're going to tell us you can achieve a standard, but we're not going to tell you the numbers that go into the metric. The other piece I just add, Julia, is you ask about the Housing Appeals Committee. Anyone who's ever appeared before the Housing Appeals Committee, whether you're representing a developer or you're representing a municipality, I think is going to have the same takeaway, which is it's not an objective tribunal. It's not. I've appeared before the HAC innumerable times. I've never had once the sense that it was an objective tribunal. And here's the real kicker. You don't appear before the Housing Appeals Committee. It's a five-member committee. You appear before one person. The decision is made by five people. Now, would we tolerate that in any kind of other judicial proceeding? That we're going to appear before one person, we're going to have evidence and testimony before one person, but the decision's going to be made by four additional people who you'll never see. Who you'll never see. Every attempt in my career to have oral argument before the full committee, denied. I don't know one attorney in the Commonwealth that's ever had full argument or argument before the full committee. How would we tolerate that in any other subject matter? We wouldn't. But in this case, we do, because we're all afraid to raise this issue. Five-member committee, one person appears on behalf of the committee, five members adjudicate the decision. Any other society would reject that. We tolerate it. It's unacceptable.
And just to be clear, their deliberations are not public meetings. They're not open to the public. So it's as if your zoning board were convening, not for a recognized executive session, but to deliberate on a matter that no one is allowed to see or witness the deliberation.
I've got a question about golf courses. And I know, Dennis, you probably can't talk about things you did internally as an employee in the law department, but could both of you address the issue of whether golf courses are considered developable land, not developable land, and the implication of that is whether they should be included in the denominator for doing the 1.5% calculation, of course.
Well, I don't know the facts in Newton, but I can tell you what's happening in other communities, which is the way the regulations and the statute work, and this is being litigated now, the land areas, the land area that you start with, the land areas, that land zoned residential, commercial, and industrial. So if your golf courses are not zoned residential, commercial, or industrial, or categories of similar import, they should not be included in the denominator. That's the way the regulations read. The regulations couldn't be more clear. The statute, a little less clear, but still pretty clear. You start with the land area zoned R, C, or I, residential, commercial, industrial. And by doing that, the legislature in the late 60s must have realized that land area in Provincetown, with a lot of land that is unbuildable and undevelopable and increasingly owned by the National Park Service, is different than land in Newton. So we allowed for this differentiation of land area. You start with the land zoned residential, commercial, or industrial. If golf courses are not zoned residential, commercial, or industrial, in my opinion, and now before the Superior Court in a case out of Stoneham, they shouldn't be in the denominator.
And then if they are zoned residential but have like a long-term conservation restriction, I think that's another issue to consider. And also in Newton, we have land like, for example, Webster Woods, which was recently sold to Boston College. I'm not sure if it's gone through, but a long-term conservation restriction that I think expires in, is it 2058 or something? And so it would be not developable now, but developable at some point in the future. So land like that, or the we've got a lot of properties where nonprofits don't pay taxes, but then they can sell them and make a large profit, but to the cost of the city, if that it then becomes developable. Is it worthwhile to try to do something to include those in land that is considered undevelopable?
Well, again, this is teed up before the Superior Court in the Stoneham case. You know, I think the best advice, and I defer to the staff of the city, of course, but I think the best advice is to remove land from those designations that are not intended to be in those designations. So if the intent was to keep it as a public golf course or is to keep it as a otherwise protected space, remove it from the category of residential, commercial, industrial. And again, the statute says, or similar wording, or the regulations say that. So I think you can take affirmative steps to reduce the denominator as long as in good faith the land is not developable. That was the intent of the statute.
And I'll speak on the numerator side. The one piece of advice we give to municipalities all the time is take a more entrepreneurial approach to how you manage your affordable housing assets in a community. Do it the way a private enterprise would manage a portfolio of assets, things that are eligible to be on the SHI, make a timely application and put them on the SHI. And things that are expiring use, track those expiring uses and see if negotiations can be made with the developer to extend the subsidy. Those kinds of things where a municipality has an opportunity to actively manage the numerator. Your question about golf courses, I can speak to generally. I think The argument on the side for excluding them from the denominator might stem from any recreational land that is subject to a Chapter 61 restriction that allows the owner to pay far lower property taxes in exchange for giving the municipality a right of first refusal. That right of first refusal is, by law, an interest in land. And the argument is that the municipality has a legal interest. It's not fee ownership. They don't own it outright, but they have a right of first refusal. That's a contingent interest, and therefore, it is not readily developable. I don't know that that's been fully adjudicated in a court, but that's the argument, and it could go either way.
So it has the power to stop the development, basically, if it chooses to do so.
Potentially. Yeah. The municipality, if it were presented with a bona fide offer, there's very strict rules under the statute. You have to match the offer exactly, and you have to do it within a timely manner, and et cetera, et cetera. But it gives the municipality the absolute right to buy the property before it can be sold to anyone else.
Yeah, I'm more familiar, I guess, with the farmland. We don't have a lot of farmland in Newton left, but I assume the same thing applies other contexts.
So Chapter 61 has an A, B, and C. Agriculture, I think, falls under A. B is recreation. C might be forest land. Each of them works similarly. And the other thing that would have to happen is if you were to develop it, I think there's a certain number of years you have to pay the back taxes, which is, for some properties that are many hundreds of acres, could be a very significant amount of money.
Okay. Let's take a step back. How did Chapter 40B come about in the first place? Can you talk about the historical context that led to its enactment in 1969? And is it true, as some historians have written, that 40B was Boston's revenge on the suburbs for the Racial Imbalance Act of 1965 that led to busing for school desegregation? Or was it a genuine attempt to solve the housing problem, or was it a combination of both?
I wasn't around yet, so that's why.
I was about 9, I think. Or
so I object to Mr. Murphy's connotation. So there are many people in this room that have a historical perspective on it, Julia. And I'm going to duck the question just a little bit by saying it is what it is. I've written a lot about the historical perspective, and I think it was payback, and other people have said it's payback to the Boston suburbs for not, or for supporting racial integration in the busing program. But the courts have made it clear for 40 some odd years that the statute's not going away. So it is what it is. And now I think cities and towns have to deal with it. And we deal with it by complying or fighting, or a little bit of both. My understanding is Newton's complied. So you've achieved something that many municipalities have not. To get the statute repealed has been an impossible task. It was tried not too long ago, and it failed miserably because those petitioning the repeal were outspent hundreds to one. And I suspect, and I think we all suspect, that would happen again. So like everything else in the land use scheme in Massachusetts, we're behind the times. We haven't changed the Zoning Act since 1975, imagine that. The zoning code that governs normative behavior hasn't been changed since 1975. That's incredible. The subdivision control law, similarly. So we're stuck in a legislative scheme where the legislative system and the governor has not seen fit to adopt modern land use scenarios. The American Planning Association, not too long ago, said Massachusetts was one of the most regressive planning schemes in the nation. That's the American Planning Association. No shrinking violet when it comes to affordable housing. So when we're stuck in this system, we can look at the historical context and think that maybe that might influence change, but in my experience, it hasn't. If you look at the original text in 40B, it was for returning Vietnam veterans. Well, obviously things have changed. So what is the story behind 40B? I'm not sure it's as relevant as how do we make it work or how do we change it. There hasn't been a governor since I've been in this business, and many people in this room in this business longer than I, that has seen fit to want to talk about a reform to 40B. The legislative delegation, either at the Senate or at the House, even after the Inspector General found rampant fraud, the biggest scam since the Big Dig, his quotes, The biggest scam since the Big Dig. A pig fest. This is our Inspector General used those words relating to 40B. Even with that kind of imprint put on the statute, the legislature hasn't touched it. This governor hasn't touched it. Prior governor hasn't touched it. It's not Republican or Democrat. It's fear of the development community, and it's an unwillingness to take this head on and look at what other progressive states have done to build affordable housing. So I'm ducking the question only to say is the history is the history. Massachusetts has some checkered history when it comes to race, when it comes to progressive politics, and we know that, despite our panache as this big, very liberal bastion of great thinking, that's not been historically true. And when it comes to land use practice, it's been abysmal. So my opinion is to the cities and towns that I work with and the folks that I talk to is, make it work for you, you've already accomplished that, now make it work for you to build affordable housing that fits the plan of the city of Newton, not someone else's vision of what Newton should be.
Julia, part of the reason history keeps repeating itself is politically, it's very, very difficult to do anything with the statute. The 40B allows private equity to develop affordable housing, which means the governor and the legislature don't have to allocate money out of their state budget to do so. And that makes it very, very lucrative for a governor and legislature to leave it just the way it is, however, you know, behind the times it may seem to be. You often hear told that it passed by one vote, and part of the reason it hasn't been amended in 46 years, I think, is because if you open the statute, it will end that very delicate balance that you have.
Yeah, so I guess one of the things I've noticed as a kind of a perverse effect of 40B is that it seems to benefit developers that have no actual interest in doing affordable housing themselves, but they can threaten to do a 40B if they don't get a special permit approved. I've heard of two instances of that just a few blocks from my own house in West Newton. So it sounds like there's not much hope for ever fixing that problem.
You know, not too long ago, there's an agency called Mass Housing Partnership. It's an arm of the Commonwealth. And the executive director of MHP, at I'd say 10 years ago, took the position that when a developer threatened a 40B, but had no real intention of developing a 40B, that would be looked unfavorably upon at the level of what's today typically now mass housing. Those days are over. So a developer can threaten, can provide any kind of aggressive assault against a municipality and threaten a 40B, because what the developer really wants is a special permit and they can do it with impunity. It's the ultimate club. I mean, think about it. No rules apply. Who wouldn't want to approach that? So that's part of the process.
Yeah, and I get the sense that it's not even necessarily a threat to the city or town government. It's more to the abutters who are being asked to support or not, at least not oppose, whether it's a multi-unit townhouse development or whatever near them. It's more of an informal type of threat.
The reason it's informal, Julia, is there's actually a regulation that prohibits successive applications. If you bring a application for a project under a special permit or something other than a comprehensive permit, you're barred for, I think it's a year, from bringing a comprehensive permit application on that same property for this similar project.
But even a year, it's not very long. I mean, demolition delays last a year, and developers just wait them out. I am curious about one thing. I think originally 40B was originally for nonprofit developers, and then it's somewhere along the line it changed. Could you explain that? And if there's any other kind of important cases or changes to the 40B law that have occurred in the time it's existed?
No, the statute's always included three applicants: public agencies, nonprofit agencies, and what's called limited dividend organizations. And the limited dividend organization is a private developer. So the statute originally, when it was originally drafted, always included those three categories. The bulk of its use, though, was by nonprofits. historically. So the legislature had in mind that a private entity would be able to be the applicant. But to answer the second part of the question is, so 1969, so Mass Housing, which used to be called Massachusetts Housing Finance Agency, was adopted through a legislative scheme in the 1967, 1968. They have all this money now to spend, but they have no way to spend it because there isn't a way around local zoning. So 40B comes a couple of years later, 1969. So it's 2016. It would come as a shock to, I think, most people to know that the statute written in 1969 with such an incredible effect on local governments, not one word has changed since. Not one word other than changing the name of the Department of Community Development. There's not been one change to the statute since 1969. Why? Well, because what did we do in 1979? We adopted Proposition 2.5. And what did Proposition 2.5 include? No unfunded mandates. So the legislature is not going to touch this statute in a million years, because once they touch it, it's going to open up the last thing in my playbook, which is it's a violation of Prop 2.5. Because every time you're forced to approve a new comprehensive permit project in communities that aren't consistent with local needs, like Newton, you're violating the unfunded mandate law, which Massachusetts voters adopted and have kept on the books. The statute hasn't changed since 1969, but Prop 2.5 changes everything. So when the legislature tries to go back and change the statute, which one day, someday, the legislature will have the courage to do it, it's going to implicate Prop 2.5. And Prop 2.5 requires funding. And as Dennis said so correctly, the governor and the legislature has been able to slide with 40B all these years because they don't have to pay for it. But you do, we do, and that's why we voted in, many people would say, we voted in Prop 2.5.
Okay, well, maybe just before we go to audience questions, could you each tell us a little bit about what kind of things you're working on now? I understand, John, you teach at a couple of schools, and Dennis, you're both working with local communities a lot. What's going on now?
I have a practice with a former colleague that I went to law school with, zoning, permitting, land use. It involves quite a bit of Chapter 40B, not by design. It's just because most zoning and land use now on the developer side implicates 40B, so it's become a very large part of my practice.
And we too, we represent a lot of cities and towns as municipal council or special council, and predominantly in the land use arena.
And your students are interested in this topic too?
They are. Yes.
Okay, well, thank you very much. I think I can take a rest now, and we'll turn it over to the audience for questions.
Has 40B worked? There are 351 cities and towns in Massachusetts. How many of them have achieved the thresholds? And has Massachusetts improved in terms of housing affordability since 1969, when Chapter 40B was enacted, or not?
I'm reading from a bureau brief on the Massachusetts Comprehensive Permit Act, Chapter 40B, by the Research Bureau, which is Worcester Regional Research Bureau out of Worcester, and they say as of December 2014, 46 of the 351 communities in Massachusetts have reached or surpassed the threshold. In the nearly 50 years since its adoption, less than 14% have met the minimum threshold, and the law has not fulfilled its purpose. I'm quoting directly from the Research Bureau.
Hi, my name is Bob Jampol. I live about half a mile from here. How affordable is the affordable housing threshold? Because I was looking at the leaflet I have here, and if it's at 80% of that price, a single person, a couple, or a small family would be paying somewhere between, depending on the size, at a typical place, if it was a rental 40B, $25,000 to $40,000 a year. Is that really considered affordable?
Well, the issue of affordable has always been affordable to whom? And this gets back to the plan requirement. So the need for affordable housing in Wareham is very different than the need for affordable housing in Newton. But yet, Wareham and Newton are using the same metric of 80% of median income. So the question about 40B's provision of affordable housing has been a decades-old debate. And once you try to make the units more affordable or require more of them in a community that isn't consistent with local needs, and that goes to the Housing Appeals Committee, the Housing Appeals Committee will strike that decision. We have decision after decision after decision at the Housing Appeals Committee, this tribunal, that says a municipality can't require greater affordability. A municipality can't add additional requirements to affordability. A municipality can't impose additional restrictions on affordability. So the very nature of the statute, create affordable housing, is thwarted by the very agency designed to make sure you're affordable. Why? Because the developer doesn't want to produce those additional units. So the question of whether 80% of median is the right target, that's totally above my pay grade. I mean, we've seen mass housing hold on to that number. We know what affordable housing means. It means 30% of median, or it means between 30 and 50% of median. But the statute says 80% of median. Why? Because it's more politically palatable to say to you, as most developers will, it's for your police officers and your firefighters and your school teachers. Well, of course that's true, but what about the real need for affordable housing, which is for my grandparents at 30% of median? So the statute has ignored what really is affordable housing for decades, and it's going to continue. Because can you find a for-profit 40B developer that wants to put units aside at 30% of median? No, they won't do it. So who are we writing the statutory scheme of 80% of median for? For the for-profit developers, some of which are coming from out of state, many of which are in state, because they won't come if it's 30 to 50%, which is what Newton, I'm assuming, needs. It's certainly what my town needs and what my communities need, not 80%.
Just to address your question about specifically about rentals, the cost of a rental is a formula that is established by HUD. It's 30% of the income, and is an it has to include utilities. So it really is a mathematical formula that generally establishes the rents for affordable units.
I also just want to clarify something. I think that gentleman was referring to a handout that we prepared, which was about the prices of market rate units. It was an analysis that John Coate did about downsizing seniors and how often 40B proposals are touted in Newton as being appropriate for downsizing seniors, but when downsizing seniors do the math, they see that these market rate units are not actually a good deal for them. And I think that's the document this gentleman was looking at. And I think this might be a good time to point out that 40B developments, because they're 75% to 80% market rate, tend to push surrounding housing prices up. They make the market rate higher in the name of affordability.
Hi, my name is Sammy O'Reilly, Nonantum. Two questions. Have you been involved in any cases where a 40B was successfully fought based on environmental reasons? And what were those reasons? I'll elaborate. And the other question is, has there ever been a successful case fought against a housing nonprofit or a housing agency that wants to put in, say, you know, we call it public housing, but it's not really municipal. It's the nonprofit that is deemed to be the housing agent. Any successful cases where citizens or groups fought that type of development? Thank you.
I can speak to the first issue. In some communities, there are bona fide health, safety, and environmental concerns. One in particular often deals with wastewater. I represented a gentleman who lived in Stowe, and we showed through scientific data that his drinking well would be polluted with effluent from the project, and that the town does not have any public water, and that as a result, he would lose his well. That was a environmental concern that was deemed to supersede, trump the need for affordable housing in that community. There aren't a lot of examples. That's a pretty stark one. You know, here's a guy who's drinking water with no alternative is going to become unpotable. As far as the second question about a public agency, I'm not aware of any projects brought by a public agency or nonprofit that have been litigated and stopped.
I would only add, and I agree with Dennis, I don't know of any specific nonprofits that were challenged successfully, certainly not through the judicial system, sometimes through a war of attrition, which is usually what a nonprofit can't handle, is a long-term, drawn-out battle. Most private developers can. But what Dennis didn't say about the first case is, his case, we were the town's attorney supporting the housing project that Dennis got overturned.
We're usually on the same side, but not that.
Just to put the facts out there. But also what Dennis doesn't say, which really is the most important part, is he won at the appeals court. The Massachusetts appeals court, again, no shrinking violet when it comes to approving 40B projects. Unanimous decision from the appeals court overturning the trial court on this particular matter of health and safety. So they are few and far between because the courts, as Dennis said earlier, are very deferential to the Housing Appeals Committee, totally deferential, but very deferential to local boards of appeals. So the issue has to be very narrow, very focused, and has to focus predominantly on one individual or two or three individuals' impacts. And drinking water is probably the best impact of aggrievement for an abutter or a plaintiff to articulate. And I think Dennis's case proved that out quite well.
I'm Ernest Lowenstein. I live in Newton Highlands. I have a question about that land area matter that you were discussing with Julia. When you said you could not find out from the municipality what the land area in question of something or other was, I didn't get the whole discussion. But the land area is not a secret. There are maps, and you could demand the maps, or you could get the maps from somebody, and you can measure the land area. What is wrong with that?
you raise a very good point. We tried to do just that. We tried everything we could imagine. If you just give us the parcel number of the group home, not the address, just the parcel number, I will undertake myself to go to the GIS map online, and I will figure out the land area. If you give us any information that can't possibly be traced back, you don't want to think that it's deliberately hiding the ball, but on the one hand, state law gives municipalities a mandate to reach a threshold, and then on the other hand, hides the facts from which to be able to do that. And group homes exist in most every community. I believe there are hundreds or at least 100 in Newton. And they all count on the SHI. They are on the list. It's just that nobody knows where they are. No agency is willing to give you the address or even the information from which to find out how much land area is associated with those properties. It seems like a very solvable solution, yet well-intentioned, pretty smart lawyers for the state are fighting mightily to keep from giving it out.
And I would add, in the Stoneham case, where the group home units are subject of dispute, at the Housing Appeals Committee hearing, the Housing Appeals Committee had testimony and information that those units were not being disclosed by the Commonwealth, despite attempts by the town of Stoneham to find out where they were. And the Housing Appeals Committee's decision said, in relevant part, you, the municipality, needs to find out where they are, and the fact that you didn't means you lose. So again, we're stuck in this totally arbitrary, completely undemocratic process of the Commonwealth holding up a standard but not allowing you to get the data to fulfill that standard. So it was the same analysis that Dennis went through in Norwood, Stoneham went through, and it's now in the Superior Court, which is you can't establish a milepost and not allow a community to try and fulfill it. You can't withhold that kind of information.
I'm Joan, and I'm from West Newton. This question might be a little bit naive because I'm still trying to absorb all the great information you guys are giving, so thank you. But why, can you explain to me why we've lived in Newton? I've lived here for over 20 years, and my husband and I have lived in West Newton for about almost 20. And I can't understand why the volume has been turned up in the last, like, 5 years or so. Like, is it that suddenly they discovered that 40B, they could do 40B housing? I can't understand why, what happened to just turn up the volume so much so that it feels like it's on every street corner and that there's projects left, right, and center. Can you help us understand that?
So it's ebbed and flowed. The volume gets turned up typically in most development when market rates drop, and of course we're in that environment now. Massachusetts is an insatiable real estate market, especially in Greater Boston, and 40B becomes just an easy vehicle, or an easier vehicle in many developers' minds, of fulfilling the development promise. It's not just been the past 5 or 10 years. Every time the market has ramped up like we're seeing now, 40B is a vehicle. One of the things that precipitated a lot of development 20 years ago was the attraction from out-of-state developers to 40B, and these are typically large rental developers, and many of them are in Newton, and you've had experience with them. So it's not just been the local developer using 40B to create what the municipality might want. It's now a very attractive technique for the real estate development industry. There was a developer out of Texas for many years that was really enamored with 40B and had looked at 40B as a godsend because, of course, local rules don't apply. Imagine if those of you that drove here, if there were no speed limits tomorrow. Local rules don't apply. So you drive as fast as you want. The IRS rules, they don't apply. Don't pay your taxes. The building code doesn't apply. So with that kind of mindset, of course, it's going to attract a lot of outside influence.
40B existed for its first 30 years without a ready source of private equity. And so there was an element of real altruism within, baked into the statute. That is, most 40B development before 1999 was by nonprofits and public agencies whose mission was to create, it really was a mission. Since the New England Fund was made a part of the 40B process, and many of the developments have been done by private development using single-purpose LDOs, limited dividend organizations, that has driven a spike in the number of private 40Bs just since in the last 15 years or so.
If I can talk again. This was on my list, and you're mentioning the out-of-state developers. Developers reminded me. You said earlier that Massachusetts is the only state with 40B type law. What do other states do? What are the other approaches that have worked to create affordable housing?
So the Massachusetts 40B statute was copied almost verbatim by the state of Rhode Island, and Rhode Island has a analogous statute in place. But the difference in Rhode Island is Rhode Island requires cities and towns to adopt a comprehensive plan. And once the plan's adopted, cities and towns have to fulfill that plan, and that includes building affordable housing. If you're fulfilling your plan, then the Trump effect of 40B, which is the Housing Appeals Committee, is not in play. So Rhode Island copied the Massachusetts statute but included the most important element that's missing in Massachusetts, which is compliance with a plan. So if we were in Rhode Island and Newton were satisfying its plan and building affordable housing according to that plan, then there'd be no appeal to the Housing Appeals Committee. Other states which are analogous to Rhode Island, California is probably the best example, Washington, Oregon, Hawaii, require cities and towns to adopt a plan and build affordable housing. And the percentage of affordable housing that's being built in those states far exceeds by an unknown factor in terms of affordable housing. Why? Because cities and towns want to build affordable housing. Cities and towns want affordable housing just like they want good schools and they want safe streets. Cities and towns aren't antagonistic to affordable housing. Only in Massachusetts, because the development community has ridden that wave of saying you're snobs, you're against affordable housing, it's racially motivated. Only here have we allowed that to take place. Cities and towns want to do the right thing. I was a selectman in my town. Of course you want to build affordable housing. But under the 40B statute, because it's so contentious, because all the normative rules get pulled aside, we get into this floor fight. So how do other states do it? They require cities to have a plan. They require cities and towns to adhere to the plan. And then they're left alone. It's a very tried and true principle that's been in play in the nation since after World War II, since zoning was adopted in the mid-50s in most cities and towns across the country.
Thank you for being here. My name is Ray Roberts. I live three houses down the street. Several things that you talked about with regard to the fact that they don't have to produce the information about the acreage that's involved or the square footage that's involved. And also that you talked to, Professor, you talked about the fact that you go before one member of the committee, but yet five deliberate and come up with a ruling. Is there any way through a ballot question or anything that we can have an impact by putting something in front of the voters? I mean, not every town is messed up by what's going on, but the people, as you say, we should be talking about fairness. And obviously, this is not a fair situation for the people who, for instance, down the street, St. Philip Neri or even back of us, the people who live close by, their lives are going to be impacted greatly by what goes up. You know, I've lived in Newton since I was born. My wife and I have lived in the house that she grew up in, and her family's been there since 1938. And anyway, what I'm asking, is there any way that we can come up with an initiative petition to prepare something that might end up being a ballot question, which would be binding, for them to add things which make sense, like the being required to show what that acreage is or the square footage is for the houses, which we're not supposed to know where they are. I think I remember looking in the paperwork that Newton provided to me way back in August, a year and a half ago, when he first became aware of what was going on at St. Philip Neri, that they show you that there are affordable housing units on certain streets, but they don't tell you the addresses. So I'm concerned that, you know, we're losing the battle to people who don't really care about our neighborhood, don't really care about Newton, they just care about the bottom line. And granted, you know, everybody has the right to make a living, but if they ruin the livelihood of the other people around who have to put up with it for 20, 30, 40, 50 years or their entire lives, it's not fundamentally fair, and it doesn't make for good community relations with those people who are trying to do that to us. We need affordable housing, but we don't need to bend over backwards and let them do whatever the heck they want just because there's 40B.
You know, one of the, from a million miles high, one of the greatest problems with 40B has been how it separates and how divisive it is neighborhood to neighborhood. Because when it's a quota standard, 10% or 1.5%, well, one theory is if the 40B is happening over there, and I live over there, that's a good thing because now the municipality will be at 10%. So we've seen that. It stigmatizes and it segregates and it focuses efforts in one community because then the major elements of the community will be satisfied. The last serious attempt to reform and repeal 40B failed miserably. It was outspent, as we said earlier. So my approach on this is it's now up to the legislature. It's up to us convincing our legislative delegation that there are other ways to create fair land use policies, including affordable housing. And sadly, and again, I don't mean to be despondent about this, but the truth is the legislative delegation has seen no interest in picking this up. If you've never read Greg Sullivan's investigations on 40B, still on their webpage, if you've never read them, then you really want to. Because it is amazing to anyone to read his reports as to what happened and what we know is happening and think that we're looking the other way. The greatest, I love these quotes so much, they're worth repeating. Greatest scandal since the Big Dig and a pig fest. This is from the Inspector General of the Commonwealth. So, sir, I can't really answer your question because I just don't see the momentum at the legislative level or the governor's office to reform it, and that's where it has to start. The ballot petition that was tried years ago failed so miserably, in part because there was just no way to raise that kind of revenue when you're fighting large out-of-state rental development corporations who have a vested interest in keeping the law the way it is.
Hi, I'm Kathy Winters. I live here in Waubun. You mentioned earlier that there are some municipalities that have met the 10% threshold and who are still successfully developing affordable housing. How do they do that? I mean, here in Newton, we have a special permit process with the inclusionary zoning ordinance. And from a developer's perspective, I'm sure it's, you know, fraught with peril to go before the city council and try to get 16 votes. So what are the alternatives for developing affordable housing?
So 40B does not go away even when you're consistent with local needs. So the two examples I used earlier were Cambridge and Amherst, two really good examples of production, using 40B as the vehicle, even though Amherst and Cambridge have been over 10% for many, many years. So the process is the same as it would be in a hostile situation, not at consistent with local needs. So the Board of Appeals entertains an application to build X number of units, but because you're at that threshold, the developer has no appeal. So whatever conditions the board imposes or denies are unappealable. The abutter's appeal is not taken away or minimized. So it gives the Board of Appeals a chance to impose the conditions of approval or denial if the project is inconsistent with the neighborhood or inconsistent with the city's vision of itself, or if there aren't enough affordable units, or if the units aren't renting or selling to 80% of 30% of median or 50%. So the process is the same, but because there's no appeal to the Housing Appeals Committee, the developer has no appeal. So the developer would then be tempted to apply for a comprehensive permit only because he or she or it knows that the city wants this project or is willing to work with them. So it creates the kind of collegial, negotiable position in land use that we, I think, all think is the appropriate way of doing it. So getting to the holy grail, getting to that threshold, is what we want. If you're there, now you control the future density and development vision of the city of Newton.
But that's still 40B, so this is not an alternative to 40B.
So it's an alternative to 40B in that the greatest threat to a municipality under 40B is the appeal to the Housing Appeals Committee.
But they're still using the comprehensive permit.
So if the city feels, if the Board of Appeals and the city feels that the comprehensive permit process is inappropriate because it's being voted on by five members of the board instead of the entire city council, then the traditional approach used by the majority of states is a special permit process, inclusionary zoning without the density bonus, inclusionary zoning as a requirement for all developments over four units or more. We have plenty of examples of that. Newton's inclusionary zoning ordinance, which has been on the books for a long time, was visionary at the time, and now it can be changed because you've achieved this status. Every new development in Newton could be required to produce 10% of its units as below market. You'll never lose that 10% or 1.5% quota. You'll always stay current, and those units will always be fulfilling your plan. So a city or town has every right under Chapter 48 to put in mandatory inclusionary zoning, to require that percentage set aside, and to fulfill the needs you seek. So maybe it's 50% of median. So you don't have to do it through 40B, but you could, and you can bootstrap that to a 40A approach.
I think the single most important thing that we can do in Newton is to make sure that our mayor and our city councilors know that we want them to defend our 1.5% status. We want them to maintain it. We want them to make sure that it never goes away. And it's really important that our public use land not get rezoned for development. I'm concerned about the economics and the finances of 40B. What we're seeing in Newton is that 40B projects are proposed on places that are commercial sites. Julia mentioned this, places that we need for our commercial tax base, because our city's $1 billion in debt. We're seeing we're seeing the displacement of naturally affordable houses or homes for people. That happened at Court Street recently, where naturally affordable units were demolished to make way for a luxury condo complex. And the fact that in the Court Street project, we saw that as soon as the developer got his permit, he expressed a great deal of interest in creating affordable housing, and he talked about his devotion to Newton. he got the permit and then sold it to someone else. And we suspect that some of the other developers plan to just flip these permitted properties as soon as they get the permit. And we're seeing that the flipping of land happens both after they get the permit and also before they get the permit. The properties can get flipped through a number of entities to drive up the price of the land so that they can claim they need to charge higher prices to make the project economic. And it's this speculative aspect of land transfer through 40B, both before the permit and after the permit, that concerns me a great deal. It's fueling the frenzy of land prices in Newton. 40B is actually making it much worse. Can you talk about that a little bit?
Inspector General Sullivan's report on the town of Berkeley was that case in point. Because 40B works on a profitable basis, the statute says that the Board of Appeals can't impose conditions that make the project uneconomic. And the word uneconomic, of course, is a magic number. So one way a developer will avoid having an economic project, so he or she or it can show it's uneconomic to impose conditions, is to move the numbers around and play with the pro forma. That's what the Inspector General found in Berkeley, a flip to a flip to a flip. So that's one of the oldest games in the 40B book, which is you deceive the public in terms of the numbers and you inflate your costs and you have machinery and cars and trucks attributable to multiple projects at the same time. So that's, again, the Inspector General's reports, I think, are probably the best ones to look for.
One of the limitations that you raised, Kathleen, is that the economics of a project are not typically reviewed by a municipality until after it's built. Under the rules, the municipality is entitled to any of the excess profits that go into its affordable housing trust fund. It's a municipal judgment, one that I think ought to be made by a zoning board about whether or not they want a very large excess profit to build up their affordable housing trust, or they want to see a project that comes in with a scale that will just barely put them there because they don't want a lot of excess profit. They'd rather have a scaled back project. And so that's one of the flaws in the structure, is that the finances are driven at the outset by the subsidizing agency and not subject to local review until after the project's built.
Hi, Lynn LeBlanc, Newtonville. I'm not sure I'm going to ask the question right, but my understanding from what you spoke about was that if a project, a 40B project, gets approved and does not conform to zoning standards, it must stay as a 40B affordable unit until, or as long as it's out of zoning, correct?
So it's the Ardmore decision that Dennis was referencing. It was a rental project. We think it's applicable to for sale projects as well. As long as the project remains non-compliant with zoning, if it was developed pursuant to a 40B, our opinion is those units must remain affordable for as long as it's non-compliant with zoning.
Okay, so my question is, Newton is going through a zoning reform right now, and if it happens that zoning changes to such a degree that units that had been out of zoning conformity come into zoning conformity, that means we lose a lot of our affordable housing. Is that correct?
So this goes back to the earlier question. It's an excellent question. It goes back to the earlier question, which is, if that were to happen, if the city council were to intentionally do that, or de facto it just happens, then the next question would be, what does the regulatory agreement, what was the deal that the city cut with the developer when those units were first created say? In many cases, especially if it's a recent regulatory agreement, the units might be restricted perpetually. So even if the city council were to bring it into compliance with zoning, there's still another opportunity to hold on to those units, and that's the regulatory agreement.
What is the regulatory agreement? Is that the comprehensive permit itself?
Regulatory agreement is the contract that gets recorded at the registry, typically between the developer and the subsidizing agency, the source of the financing. And it has the terms and conditions under which units have to remain affordable and so on and so forth.
So, and speaking of subsidizing agency, as I understand it, subsidy doesn't have to be literally money. It can be, it's almost like it can be like a blessing. This is okay. Can you explain subsidizing agency and subsidy?
For many of projects that come under this New England Fund, that's private money from the Federal Home Loan Bank of Boston, the subsidy is deemed to be the review by a quasi-state agency. You're right, it doesn't come in the form of taxpayer dollars. It comes in the form of project eligibility review conducted by staff who are on the Commonwealth payroll. They are employees of Mass Housing or, I think, by and large, Mass Housing. There are other subsidies that are used in different programs. There's literally dozens or scores of them. CDBG, Home, there's a number of private and public pools of equity available to facilitate the development of affordable housing. I'm talking about the one most commonly used for private development under 40B.
I have a question about accessory apartments. I heard that the city has no records of most of them because a lot of them are illegal. Have you heard of other towns finding a way of having them account towards the 1.5? Because I assume a lot of them are count as low income.
Yes, it's an excellent question. The town of Barnstable, about 8 years ago, maybe longer, developed an amnesty program for illegal apartments. It became very, very apparent that there were, it's Cape Cod, it's a resort community, that there would be a ton of illegal apartments. So to bring them to health and safety codes, there was a negotiation that was developed with the landlord or with the owner to bring it into code and to try and get the units to count towards the affordable goal of the community. So that this town of Barnstable, they have a town council, that they function very similar to Newton, although quite a bit smaller. So since the Barnstable approach, other towns have developed an amnesty program for illegal apartments, unlawful apartments, with the quid pro quo being there won't be any retribution or any fines for noncompliance if you bring it up to code and it's rented to a qualifying tenant at 80 or 60 or 50% of below market. So great question, and yes, we have a lot of good examples out there.
This was extremely informative, don't you think?